Hello.
Hi. Hello, everyone. I think we'll get started. My name is Sayed Muneeb Javed. I work for Ericsson. I'm part of the Ericsson development unit, and I'm part of the team that does the development and then product development introduction to different markets. So I go around, get the customer needs, see what they're doing, and then based on that, bring back that feedback. Try not only to improve the product, but the process as well. My friend Constantine, he couldn't make it. The problem with being really good is that you're in demand, and when you want to go to sessions like these, and we wanted to drag him along, well, he had important, more better things to do. So he's the one. He's also part of the development team, and he's the one who knows almost everything about everything. I know it's a cliche to say that. But if you talk about Go programming, if you talk about shell scripting, you talk about Linux, you talk about new, you go and talk to the guy, and it can be hours before you actually leave the conversation. And then Sohail.
Yeah, my name is Sohail Aham. Actually, I'm a cloud solution architect in cloud platform team in Ericsson. Yeah. So we have I'm doing all the cloud pre-sales and post-sales activities within Ericsson.
Sohail is responsible for region North America. So he works with the local customers. And he'll be able to give you the local perspective, and I work with the global customers. So you'll be able to hear what the customers globally are doing and what specifically is being done here in North America. So let's get right into it. Our expectation is that people who are here, they have basic knowledge about OpenStack. I mean, we are all part of the community, and we are learning as we go. So you have basic knowledge of OpenStack, you know a bit about networking, and understand the architectural choices. I mean, that's the most important part of it. OpenStack gives you a framework of how you want to or how you can deploy your system to be, but it doesn't tell you exactly what you need to do. So you have to figure out what you want, how you want, and put the pieces together. So those are the choices that we are not going to go into the details. We picked up a couple of scenarios that we found were very common with our customers, and we've tried to do the troubleshooting techniques around that. And then Neutron details, we put that there in the slide for the people who are new to OpenStack. It's not what we are going into the details. So I've been to Vancouver, I've been to Paris. Every time there's a lot of people who are just beginning to look into OpenStack. So anyone who's new or is getting his hands dirty now with OpenStack, these slides are for them basically. So after the presentation, they have had a chance to look at the details, and so this is where we want to get started. When we talk about cloud troubleshooting, and it's not specifically Neutron troubleshooting, it's cloud troubleshooting. When we talk about that kind of troubleshooting, there's a certain set of tools that you absolutely need. Not only you need to know these tools, you need to know a little bit of details about these tools. So we put them together, and this could be a good slide. I mean, I'm pretty sure most of us here know all these tools. We'll give a few examples about ARP, for example. Everybody knows ARP entry, right? But if you're doing testing with a VM that's not able to talk to a namespace, and you want to see the ARP cache, and you want to clear the ARP cache, then you do dash D option, and it clears it out. Things like that. Ping with a count option, or ping with the different size of the packet. So if you're doing troubleshooting and you see that the certain packets are going through and others are not, and you see that, oh, my ping is working just fine, but when I start the TCP session, I realize that certain packets in the beginning of the TCP handshake work, but when the payload starts flowing, it doesn't work. So how do you troubleshoot that? So ping could be a pretty good tool there. So you can select a packet size and see if the MTU size in all the segments where your packet is flowing could actually be tested through that. ARPing, that's a very interesting tool. When we were putting this toolkit together, we installed the tool because our approach is to start from the ground up. If the layer two is fine, layer one is fine, and that's a given, we expect that. If layer one is fine, then the second step is layer two. To test layer two, I didn't know about this tool, ARPing, and Constantine introduced me to that. So we installed that on our controller, on our network node. As soon as we install that, we are seeing the packages that are being installed, and we get this funny message. L3 agent will be deleted. It's like, what? So that was interesting. So something to watch out for. Make sure that you don't install it where you're running the L3 agent. TCP dump. I think that's by far one of the most useful tools that we've come across. There are limitations with TCP dump. So for example, if you're using DPDK or if you're using SROV, then TCP dump doesn't really cut or doesn't really do what you would want it to do. So there are ways around it, and maybe we can talk a bit about that as well. IPA, bridges, OVS, NetStat, and IP tables. So let's go a bit into details. So bridges. We've seen deployments where you have an option of bypassing the Linux bridge provided by the OpenV switch. So let me go a little bit here. So yeah, maybe I can talk about this, and then I'll connect the bridges. So if you look at this particular diagram, you see this part right there. This is the bridge, right? This is the Linux bridge. And when I started looking into OpenStack, I was asking people, why the hell do you need that particular bridge there? The more legs that you add to a flow, the slower the flow becomes, you know? I mean, if you want to go to Paris, you're not going to go to New York and Montreal. And you want to go to Paris, you go to Paris, right? So the reason behind this bridge is the security. And that's why when we go back, this is, so you need to know a bit about Linux bridges as well. And then how the Linux bridges will connect to the IP tables. OVS tools. So OVS, as far as I know, is most widely deployed in commercial. And if you want to know about OpenStack networking, OVS is your best friend. And when we talk about the OVS flows, there are the data path and open control flows. If you know about these two, I think you'll be OK. But if you've not started looking into that, I think it's a good time to do that. So we'll talk about how the flow actually goes. We have the diagram that will show the packet going from one place to another. And then we'll discuss how you can actually trace that packet. And in the end, we have a surprise for you, because we'll tell you how the packet flows, but that's not how the pros do it. There's a different way to go about it, and we'll leave it to the end. Debug step, yeah. And okay, so let's go right into the common architecture. And that's where I was saying that we will not go into the details of how you have deployed your OpenStack, you know. We are assuming that this is the most commonly deployed architecture. And we'll keep that as a reference, and we'll discuss how you can troubleshoot this. There's about 9 steps in this when a packet flows from the VM to the namespace or when it goes externally, more or less 9. If you can troubleshoot this, or if you can find out about these points, you can apply the same scenario, or you can apply the same concepts to almost anything else. So we'll go through this diagram. And here what we're showing is that you've got 2 compute nodes, compute 1 and compute 2. And then you've got a controller node, or you can call it a network node, whatever, where basically your DHCP agent is running, your L3 agent is running. And typically speaking, your VM will be connected to a tap port. That tap will be connected to a Linux bridge. And this is where the security groups will be applied. As I was saying earlier, I mean, there's a choice for you to bypass that. So if you're a private cloud, or if you have trusted applications, for one reason or another, I mean, there's uncountable options. You do have the option to bypass this and hook up your tap directly to brint. But this is for the security, and this is the typical deployment that we've seen. After that, you've got a veth pair, and then you've got the integration bridge. The integration bridge actually is a smart bridge that will do the internal switching, and we'll go more into details about that. And then the integration bridge connects to your physical port. The physical port connects to a layer 2 switch, and we are seeing a lot of the customers, they want their switches to be controlled by SDN, and we actually do provide a solution where you don't actually, when you create a network, the VLAN, the corresponding ports on the computes, they get pushed directly onto the switches. Which is a really nice thing, because everything becomes automated, you script it. The drawback, however, is if something fails, it also adds another thing that you need to troubleshoot. So when we talk about the layer two switches, just keep in mind whatever company, whatever switch you have, port mirroring on the switch could also be your best friend, especially when you're doing troubleshooting with the SIRV, and you're trying to prove that the packet is leaving compute. TCP dump is not going to help you there. OVS is not going to help you there. Port mirroring could be one option. And for particular vendors, I've looked into the Ciscos, the Junipers, the Extremes, and they all support port mirroring. And so basically, that's vendor dependent, and we don't go into those details. So when we get started, most of the deployments, they use DNS mask. So let's pick up a very simple scenario in which your DNS mask process is running on your controller node, on your network node, and your VM wants to connect to it to get the IP address. So as soon as you run your DNS mask process, make sure that you go into your namespace and make sure that the process is running. There's a lot of times, especially in the beginning, I was trying to find out, oh, wait, why is it not listening on port 67? Long behold, yeah, you have to go into the namespace back in the days. And then each of the process, whenever you create a subnet and DNS mask, make sure that you have the corresponding process running in your host. So with that, now, once you've made sure that your DNS process is running, then we go right into the use case where your VM, you boot a VM, and you want to dynamically allocate the IP to the VM. The VM comes up, Nova boots it, Neutron connects the ports, everything is so far so good. Then the VM sends the boot P request. It goes to the, it traverses through all these ports, the ports that we've talked about before. And then it finally makes all its way to the process, DNS mask. DNS mask replies back, okay, here's your offer, this is the IP you can get. Long behold, if everything works fine, your VM will be able to get the IP address. But this right here is the crux of it. If you can master how to troubleshoot this path, it's more or less the same for everything else, or more options than not. The only difference, or the slight difference that you can see, or another option that you can see perhaps, is when your VM tries to go to the external network. So then there's one more layer that you need to look at. And we have that case covered as well. So we'll go into that, and we'll tell you what to look for and where the problem can be. So let's go right into the OVS flows. Because as I was trying to say, so at all these points, the places where we have numbers, these are the places where you can run a TCP dump to make sure that your packet is being received or not. If your packet is not received, then you need to troubleshoot either one layer above it or one layer below it. You can run TCP dump to do that, and that can be a good starting point, but that's not what we suggest. So to start with a simple case, if your VM is actually not getting the IP that it needs, then you need to troubleshoot. Instead of running the TCP dump on all these points, maybe start with something simple. Maybe dump the kernel, maybe dump the data path. So on the compute where you're running your VM, you can see actually what the hell is going on. Is the VM really sending something out? If the VM is sending something out, is it going on the right port? Is it using the right VLAN? Things like that. So if you can decipher this message right there, then you're pretty good. You're in good shape to find out, okay, or you have a good clue to know where the next problem could be. Instead of going back and tracing 9 different points, you know, which can be overwhelming, could be a waste of time, and it's not efficient as well. So you run this, and basically, okay, so let's go through this quickly. It would have been nice, and I think this is what we'll do for the next time. We'll take a count of hands to see how many people are familiar with this, and then we'll adjust the explanation to see how much depth we need to go in. But for now, I assume that most of you know a little bit about this flow. So I'll go through this quickly, and if you have more questions, then we can take the questions towards the end, and we can explain it a bit better. So what you're looking at here right now is all these ports, So these are the ports which exist within your host, right? But OVS doesn't map these ports. OVS has a different way of mapping these ports. So for example, ETH2 that you see, this port right here, which is connected to the external switch, this is mapped in OVS as port 4. QVO B2C, which is right here. This is mapped in OVS as port 8. So when you dump the flows, what you're actually looking for is, am I receiving packet in port 8? So port 8 will correspond to this. If you're receiving packet there, it means that the VM is trying to send something out. The next thing you check is the source MAC address. So when you create the Neutron port or when you try to boot the VM, this is the MAC address that the VM will get. You can check it from either DHCP lease, and those logs are present in your controller logs, and I can point you to where exactly they are. You can look at the MAC address there and make sure that the VM is using the correct MAC, because this is what's been established and pushed forward. And then we see that, okay, so it is trying to send a broadcast. Very good. So far, so good. And the next thing you're looking for is that the flow will enforce to push VLAN 2020. So when you do Neutron net create, this is the VLAN that will be pushed and configured on the external switches. So this path right here is using VLAN 2020. So you make sure that, yeah, okay, the correct VLAN will be tagged onto this frame, and the frame will be sent to port 4. Port 4, as we were talking, port 3 and 4, my apologies. So port 3 and 4, they correspond to this part right there. So just looking at this line tells you that, you know what, okay, my problem most probably is not within the compute. I see that the VM is trying to send the packet out, and it's sending it with the right parameters. That's the most important thing. And once you've established that, then the next step becomes, then, okay, so if that's correct, then the most probably the problem is on the other side, and you need to start troubleshooting on the other side. On the other side, you do the exact same thing. You dump the flows, and you see if the packet is received in the correct port with the right source MAC address, with the right destination MAC address, and the VLANs are pushed correctly. We've seen many times that OVS is a pretty stable tool for the most part, but we've seen a lot of times that if you have a funky configuration, it will show that the packet is being received in the correct port, but it will put some strange VLANs on top of that. You restart the process, and you see if the configuration is as per the guidelines, and things start working well. But if you don't want to go into the details of the configuration files, you want to find out right away if there could be a problem with the VLAN or the MAC, you look at the flow, and you get a pretty good idea of where the problem could be. So this is a screenshot of the same thing that I explained earlier. We are making sure that the port's action means that this will be sent out to this port. Import means that the packet is received on this particular port. And the rest of the details are the same. Now, after you've dumped the flows, you can run TCP dump as well. And TCP dump, here we are running on QBR. So QBR is right there. This is the bridge. And this bridge will tell you, okay, so what is the flow of the packets? You know, am I receiving the packets correctly or not as well? So that could be the second thing. And then TCP dump options. As I was saying, TCP dump is your best friend. And the more options, the more you learn TCP, the better. Because no, that's okay. Well, I was hoping that we don't look very intimidating, you know, so you can come to the front. And I'm pretty sure that we'll share some of our experiences, but I'm pretty sure we'll pick a few things from everybody here as well. So it's a two-way stream. We give some, we take some, you know. So. Maybe it's a wake-up call as well, you know, for the people who are dozing off. Like, okay, so we're pretty settled. So yeah, going back to the TCP dump is or could be your best friend. The more options you know, the better. In the beginning, when we were running TCP dump, we'll do TCP dump on this particular interface, and then we'll dump all the packets. But when we started working more in production, we realized you can't really do that. You know, you've got 10 gig links, and you've got multiple VMs. You've got a whole lot of thing going on in that particular NIC. So you don't want to run just TCP dump on that interface. You want to narrow it down to as much detail as you can. You can do it on the Mac. You can do it on the source IP, destination IP, source Mac, destination Mac, ports, and whatever not. So make sure that you, if you're troubleshooting cloud, you know TCP dump on the back of your hand, you know. And towards the end, as I was saying, we'll give you some more examples, and we'll tell you how we do it. Here, the important thing is, again, to make sure that you see that the MAC addresses are okay. The MAC addresses are correct. And we are doing the trouble. We did this TCP dump on DHCP port because that's what we're troubleshooting. TCP dump in the namespace. Again, this slide is for the people who are relatively new to OpenStack. I mean, how do you find the namespace, the name of the namespace? How do you connect the dots and actually finally go into the namespace? But one thing that we'd like to point out is this LN option. TCP dump is awesome, but like anything else, it's not perfect. You put the LN option and it becomes a lot better. So it doesn't buffer the packets and you start seeing the packet flow right there. It doesn't overflow the buffer. So that's one recommendation, or that could be one takeaway. If you don't take anything else away from the presentation, take the LN option, and I'm sure you'll buy me a coffee next time we meet. Going back again to the VM not getting the IP address. If your VM is not getting the IP address, one option could be that you configure the log into the console of the VM and give it the IP manually. Once you give the IP to the VM manually, that opens a bigger box of troubleshooting. Because if you don't give it the IP, you can still log on, and then you have to again and again execute the DHCP request, send the DHCP request. So if you give it the IP manually, now you're in control. You can send any packet you want whenever you want. So what we found out is that if you give it the IP, then you can start the ping, and you can stop the ping whenever you want, and you can create the flows and look at the flows instead of restarting the interface or restarting the DHCP to get the IP. That could be a good option as well, and something to keep in mind. VM to VM flow, the only thing, it's more or less the same, where basically you'll still see the packets on the points that we've highlighted here. But the difference is the packet is not going out. You know, the packet is actually being switched from here to here. It doesn't even hit br int. The ARP will, but everything else goes directly between the ports.
Yeah. Okay. So in this scenario, actually, we have three use cases. So which we will explain you how you can troubleshoot and which part of the port or the OVS switch you can troubleshoot. The first scenario is our VM to VM flow. Both of the VM are on the same compute. Actually, our scenario is we have a one compute and the one controller, and the controller has also compute node. So in this scenario, you can see like we have a six steps, like the packet flows from when the VM one initiate the ping request. So you can see the tap interfaces which connects to the bridge interfaces and then the other one. Let me go to the other scenario, and then I will explain you each step with the screenshot, like which I did. And the second scenario is when our VM is on the other compute node. So in this case, we cover like if we have another physical host machine, and then how the packet will flow from one machine to another machine. And the third one is like if you want to connect to the internet, external interface on the switch side. So let's go all these steps one by one. Actually, we have. Okay, can you see now? Is good? Okay, so. Okay, so the first scenario is VM to VM flow on the same host. So first you need to check on the controller node that your VM IP. So Nova list, if you will know the VM IP. So if you see the port, if you want to know the port list of that VM, so just do Neutron port list, grep, and the IP address. The important thing of this command is you have to take that 11 character from that port list, because that 11 character will be used for your TAP interfaces, your QBR interfaces, and your QVO interfaces, just like I showed you here. So if you see here, so you'll see that this TAP interface, these 11 characters, right? And the QBR is 11 characters, and the QVO and the QVO, these all 11 characters come from that port ID, which we did from a Neutron port list. So the same thing is for the other VM. So now the next step is, like, you have to see the instance, which where that instance is running. Of course, we have only one compute node. Our both instances are running on the same compute node. When we do watch list, you can see your instances are instances 1D and the instance 1E. So if you do brctl command, which is a bridge command, you can also you can see the which that bridge connected to which port, that connected to QBR and the TAP interfaces. Yeah.
Just a quick interruption. Sorry about that. You'll take this document with you. We'll give you a link. I know we are going a bit fast, but we have a lot to cover. When you go back to your environment, you follow the rules, monkey see, monkey do kind of thing, you know? And then you'll start to realize that, yeah, this could be a systematic approach how you can go about and collect the information.
Okay.
Sorry.
So now, this is the first scenario, VM to VM flow on the same host. Let me go, okay. So now you can also check that 11 character. If you go to your compute host and if you grab on that 11 character, you can see that all the bridges and port are connected. All the bridges have been created. So that's the one step. Other one, like if you go to the VM, you can see the MAC address. It's just for your reference, like whenever you troubleshoot, you would know that which MAC address you are using here. So now let's start from the ping. So I'm trying to ping from VM1, which is a 1.4, and to VM2, which is 1.5. So once you ping it, you can do TCP dump on all those hops, like TAP interfaces, on QBR interfaces, QVB, and the QVO interfaces. You can see the request goes to 1.4 to 1.5, and then we have an echo reply, everything, yeah. And then on the OVS side, as Sayed explained, like when you do the dump of OVS, and you can see the port number is of 5 and 3, you can see here OVS like is packet is going from port number 5, which is this QVO bridge, and going towards 6, which is a QVO on another VM, yeah, just like this. So I mean, when we do ping, packet is going from this QVO port to WET port to this QVO port, because that's the internal. So you cannot troubleshoot more on this, yeah. So only this one, this way, OVS DPS, DPCTL, you can see that the ports are like, your packets are flowing from one port to another port. And on other VM, you can also see the same TCP dump on all those ports, yeah. So that's the one first scenario. The second one is like if your VM is on another compute node. In our case, our controller is our compute node. So all the steps will be same. Everything is same. Only difference is when we do the OVS DPCTL show, here you can see the packets is going towards the ETH2, which is our physical interface of that compute node, yeah. And you can see that here is that push the VLAN of 2020 because that's a segmentation ID which we put in our the network, and then the same ID we will have in our switch. And then if you think we have some problem still it's not reaching, you can also troubleshoot port mirroring on our switch, yeah, on some switch any. Okay, on other side of the compute where the other VM is exist, when you do OVS DPCTL show, you can see that port is coming from the ETH2, which is the physical interfaces, and then comes to this QVO port, which attached to the VM2 interfaces, yeah. And then also it pop the VLAN because it will pop the VLAN and then send the packet to outside of that bridge interface. This is a scenario you can see here. So everything is same here. So let me go to the last step, last scenario. Okay. So the last one is a VM to external flow. If you want to ping or like troubleshoot your VM like from the external side, yeah. So in this scenario, mostly is everything is same when we troubleshoot from the external side, like when your packet reaches to the namespace or the router namespace, how you can troubleshoot it. So here you can see OVS DPCTL show its packet is receiving from the ETH2, which is the physical interfaces of that VM, and then it's sending packet to the QR, which is a QR port attached to that namespace router. Yeah. So here is QR59863. So if you want to see more information about that namespace, if you do IP net NS on that or of your second like external node or controller node, which is the network where the network is running, Neutron is running, so you can take this 11 character, same 11 character from the Neutron port, and then you can search this 11 character inside this IP net NS command. So you can see this, you will have a QR port created inside that Neutron router, yeah. And then when you do TCP dump on this Q router, you can see here, like, because we ping from VM1 to external interfaces, which is a public IP, you can see the translate here, like it's translating the IP, like it's pinging the IP, external IP. So how the translate works is the NAT interface on the IP table. So the NAT, how the netting is work, SNAT. So if you see inside this IP net NS IP tables, you can see that SNAT is like translating your public IP, private IP into the public IP. Yeah. Okay, now your packet is on the QR. Now from the, if you do again on the OVCTL again on your with that MAC address, you can see that your packet is moving from your QR router to QG port. Yeah. So in this scenario, let me show you here. So your packet is like here. So now it's, if you see OVS DPCTL here, you can see that your packet is from QG to moving into external interfaces and your bridge or like switch router, yeah. So now let's, we have, actually that's how like everyone does it. So now we will show you how the like professional do it, yeah. So.
Yeah. So, yeah, we will keep it light.
So something, yeah. So see, yeah.
So yeah. So he'll explain different kinds of flows, and you know, then we'll share this document with you. Using this document, monkey see, monkey do kind of approach, you can list everything. It will show you the ports. It will list the MAC addresses, and then you can manually connect these things together, right? And if you do it manually, then yeah, not only it takes time, but it's cumbersome. And when you have to do it over and over again, it becomes pretty boring. I mean, there's no fun in it anymore. So instead of doing that, we started collecting scenarios that actually fail. And based on those failing scenarios, based on those most common scenarios that fail, what we did was we created a little script for us. We call it the magic genie inside in our shop, but maybe we share a bit of it. And it's not really clean yet because, I mean, it's for our internal use. So we do plan to clean it and then share it with everyone else. You can use it as for your own reference, for your own architecture, add things to it, and you know, do whatever needs to be done. So let's dig right into it. So if you do Nova list, currently we've got 6 VMs running. There's 2 different networks. And so because of the lack of time, I would have wanted to create a live network, a new VM. I don't think we have time for that. So I'll use an existing VM, and then it would have been nicer actually to create a new network. But let's, let's run with it and see how far we can go. So for example, if I have VM1 or any other VM, could be VM1 to VM6, and I'm having network troubles, my networks are not working fine, I want my script, I want my magic genie to just take the VM and then get everything that's connected to that VM. Whatever network it's connected to, whatever tap ports, QBR, QVO, whatever the IP rules are, wherever tags are connected, I want everything to be done automatically. I don't want to go into the details and then connecting the dots together. So let's run with it. And yep, that's me being nervous. Oh. That doesn't look pretty, does it? Let's try to do it again. See if we can do it better this time. OK, so it asks you for a VM name. You can give it a VM name or a VM UUID. If there's multiple, it will ask you, OK, please give me a unique ID. If there, you know, I mean, nothing can be made stupid free. So you have to be, you know, for the lack of a better word. So the script goes in, takes a VM, and then it starts collecting everything around it. So it's telling me, OK, so this is my private IP. This is my associated floating IP. Aha. So it finds out that right now, VM is not pingable from the namespace. It says, OK, I'll try to find the problem. VM is connected to these ports. So it starts the packet capture. So remember the ports that we were talking about, the OVS ports? Aha, OK. So ARP request sent successfully, but the ARP reply is not received. Problem could be on the top of the rack switch. So just to quickly go over this, and then we'll fix the problem and see what will be the outcome. So basically, I give it a VM name, and then everything that Sohail talked to you before, how you collect the information, the 11 characters of the VM ports, the IP addresses, the QVR, QBO, the script does everything for you. If, and then it tests the connectivity towards, from the namespace towards the VM. It can be other way as well, if you own the VM, of course. So yeah, it runs the connectivity towards the VM, and it finds an error message. Now, when it finds the error message, it will not just leave it there. It's not going to hang out. We want the script to tell us where could be the problem, you know. Instead of us doing the TCP dump and all kind of funky stuff on 9 different flow, we want the script to be smart enough to actually at least point us to the direction where the problem could be. So it starts the packet capture. It runs the packet capture. And then it dumps the packets in a file. It analyzes the file on what is the expected behavior. The VLANs, the MACs, the ingress port, the egress port, everything. Because if you think about it, all this information is already there. All you need to do is make a program which is smart enough to do what a human will do. So that's what we've done. And it collects that information and makes sure that the flows are OK. Now, if we can go ahead and let's see. Show port 30, 34, and OK. So they've enabled that port. Yeah, so that basically creates a broadcast storm. And they should not be here. They are in different VLAN. Show VLAN.
Maybe the physical ifconfig port was on.
Oh, OK.
Disconnect to VM1. Mm-hmm. So we will connect to the VM1 because it's saying that it would be a Tor switch port problem or the compute switch problem. Might be the port in the compute, yeah.
So Hale keeps me, he keeps me on my toes. I go in and create problems for him and challenge him to fix it, and he does the same thing. Now, he didn't tell me that this will be a surprise because he'll do it live when I'm doing the demo. Thank you, Sohail. But he did save me the embarrassment by, you know, not, I could have panicked there. So I said, okay, you know what, I'll, Okay, so. Did we put it down here or?
Yeah, if config.
Okay, I told the guys not to mess up with this, but yeah, that's a fun part of sharing the environment as well. So I know the tap interface and okay. Let's run with it again. Let's see if it really is a problem. Let's see with VM3. We were playing with it last night, and I think that's one of the worst things you can do, you know. Right before you're going in and doing the demo. Okay. So yeah, same story, basically. It finds out this is the tap, okay. Packet capture successful. It sends the ping, and the ping is successful as well. Okay, good stuff. So what if we did this? Okay, so now we've disconnected the VMs from the namespace. Let's run the same thing, and it should be able to find out that there's, well, it needs to, yeah, it must find out. It will find out where the problem is, and then we'll be able to go in and fix the problem. But not only this, but it also works with the namespaces. It looks at your natting. It does a whole lot of things. We've stripped, yeah, so there you go right there. It's not pingable. I'll try to find the problem for you. Then it starts dumping. Okay, this is the network. So you see 2020, this is the external network which is connected on your top of the rack switch. The internal VLAN ID that's mapped to it is VLAN 1. The ports are ports 7 and 5. It starts the packet capture. So analysis, checking if the ARP request, okay, so the ARP request was sent out successfully, but it doesn't receive anything back. So that's basically it. We've got this with a lot of other scenarios covered, but unfortunately, we don't have time to go into that. I promise next time if we do this demo, we are going to cover a whole lot scenario, not just this, but we'll take it one notch up. We also wanted to cover DPDK and SRV, but we didn't know about the level. So next time when we do this around in Barcelona, hopefully see you all there. We'll talk a lot about DPDK, how to troubleshoot that, and how to troubleshoot SRV. That's been one of the most fun parts that we've seen. It's not very well covered. I think there's a lot of work that needs to go out there.
Yeah, we have a link to download the troubleshooting document. All the steps here.
Yeah. So thank you very much for your time. If you have any questions, we'll be. Thank you.